The honored guests for the occasion have arrived. I request you to stand for them. A very good evening to one and all present here. Esteemed Chief Guest, Shri Adi Godrej, Chairman Godrej Group, Godrej Industries Limited, Shri Rajiv Kaul, Chairman, Board of Governors, XIMB and XUB, Professor Dr. Father Paul Fernandez, Vice Chancellor, Xavier University and Director, XIMB, Professor Father E.A. Augustine, Registrar, Xavier University, Professor Subhajyoti Ray, Dean Academics, XIMB, members of the Board of Governors of XIMB and XUB, guests, members from the media, faculty, staff, and students. On behalf of XIMB Xavier University, I, Prachi Pant, extend a very warm and cordial welcome to all of you for the 16th Foundation Day lecture. This year, we are enormously proud to host Shri Adi Godrej, Chairman, Godrej Group, Godrej Industries Limited. The Godrej Group is a global conglomerate headquartered in India, having a strong presence in consumer goods, real estate, appliances, and myriad other sectors. Mr. Adi Godrej is a global entrepreneur and business leader to reckon with. We at Xavier University are certainly delighted and extremely pleased to have you amongst us today, sir. I request our Dean, Professor Subhajyoti Ray, to welcome the chief guest. We are happy to have with us this evening Shri Rajiv Kaul, Chairman, Board of Governors, XIMB and XUB. We warmly welcome you, sir. We also cordially welcome our Vice Chancellor and Director, Dr. Father Paul Fernandez. Welcome, Father. We welcome our Registrar, Father E.A. Augustine. Welcome, Father. And we would also like to welcome Professor Subhajyoti Ray, Dean XIMB. Welcome, sir. Now, we begin this evening's proceedings with a prayer song by the choir. Yes.
നിരകാര നിരസ പാമ പാമ ഗ നിരകാര നിരസ
May I now request Shri Rajiv Kaul, Chairman, Board of Governors, XIMB and XUB, to deliver the inaugural address.
Our respected chief guest and my very dear friend, Mr. Adi Godrej, Chairman of the Godrej Group, my colleagues on the Board of Governors of both XIMB and XUB, Father Provincial George Fernandez, Father Paul Fernandez, our Vice Chancellor, Father Felix Raj, who we have as our Vice Chancellor coming from Calcutta, also of the Xavier's University, Father Augustine, my friend and registrar, our Dean, Subhajoshi Jyoti Ray, members of the faculty, our bright young students, distinguished guests, members of the staff, ladies and gentlemen. It is with the greatest of pleasure that I extend a warm welcome to all of you on our Foundation Day lecture. A very special welcome goes out to our chief guest, Mr. Adi Godrej, who I have been fortunate to have as a friend for the past several years, indeed perhaps a few decades. He is an exceptional individual who I have had the good fortune to work with and admire at CII. Adi has the rare distinction of having received his MBA from the Sloan School of Business of Management in MIT, one of the best universities in the world, and indeed where he was a member of the Pi Beta Phi fraternity and also a member of Tau Beta Pi, both very, very prestigious membership fraternities and associations. He is an outstanding leader, a leader who has a clear vision, a leader who builds confidence and consensus, a leader who inspires, a leader who believes in teamwork and team spirit, a leader who contributes a great deal to society and indeed nation building, and above all, a leader full of humility. May I request all of you to carry a warm welcome of applause to our chief guest, Mr. Adi Godrej. Thank you, Adi, for being with us and sparing so much of your time. That's one of the biggest applauses we've got, Adi. I've been here 20 years, all right? And that means 20 into two functions, 40 functions, and that's one of the biggest applauses. So obviously, you're a very popular leader as well amongst our young students over here. Well, Mr. Adi Godrej is coming here for the second time, I think, in March 2011 or 12. Not sure, right. Anyway, it was either March 2011 or 2012. He came here as our chief guest at our convocation. And many of our alumni have now, of course, received the degree and medals from him. And they are probably out spreading the word of good management, spreading the Xavier's message all over India and perhaps in various parts of the world. But it's a great pleasure to have you again this time. And it's always a pleasure, but this time it's a special pleasure, Adi, because for the very first time, Xavier's University, not XIMB, but Xavier's University, which has now been running for just over 4 years, is going to give our first ever honorary doctorate. And that's to you, Adi. A big hand for that. I'm sure many, many captains of industry and other illustrious leaders will follow you, and we look forward to that. But thank you for being the first one to come here and accept it. So may I once again request a warm applause and then request Father Augustine to read out the citation.
Conferment of Honorary Doctorate in Management on Sri Adi Godrej on 5th December 2018. Citation. Sri Adi Godrej was born in a business family in Mumbai. At the age of 17, he left India and got enrolled at the MIT in the United States to study mechanical engineering, but ended up studying management. He received his bachelor's and master's degree in management from the Sloan School, MIT, in 1963. After completing his graduation, Adi Godrej returned to India and joined the family business, the Godrej Group, which was established in 1897. Under his dynamic leadership, the Godrej Group kept on overhauling growth targets and reached great heights of success. Adi Godrej started the group's movement away from family hegemony by appointing professional CEOs from outside the Godrej family to head the various group companies. His persistent efforts led to the restructuring of many company policies for meeting challenges of globalization and liberalization. Today, Adi Godrej is the chairman of the Godrej Group and several entities that are part of one of India's leading, most trusted and respected conglomerates. Godrej has a customer base of over 470 million Indians. It is present in more than 60 countries, and 20% of its business is done overseas. Mr. Godrej is a past president of the Confederation of Indian Industry, and he has led key organizations of trade and commerce. He is the past chairman of the board of Indian School of Business. He has been a member of the Dean's Advisory Council of the MIT Sloan School of Management, a member of the Wharton Asian Executive Board, and a former chairman of the Governing Council of the Narsi Munji Institute of Management Studies. Mr. Godrej is a recipient of several awards and recognitions, including the Rajiv Gandhi Award in 2002, the American India Foundation Leadership in Philanthropy Award in 2010, the Ernst & Young Entrepreneur of the Year in 2012, the Padma Bhushan in 2013, the Asian Awards Entrepreneur of the Year 2013, the All India Management Association Business Leader of the Year 2015, the Clinton Global Citizen Award 2016 for his leadership in the private sector, the Lifetime Achievement Award at the 11th CNBC Awards Real Estate Awards 2016-17, Sir Jahangir Gandhi Medal for Industrial and Social Peace at the 61st Annual Convocation of XLRI in March 2017, Global Leadership Award at the US-India Business Council Leadership Summit, Washington, D.C. in June 2017, the Lifetime Achievement Award at the Forbes India Leadership Awards 2017, All India Management Association Lifetime Achievement Award for Management of the Year 2017, Lifetime Achievement in Ethical Leadership and Governance 2017 by the Asian Center of Corporate Governance and Sustainability. The list looks longer, but I think I am curtailing it. It's much more. Okay. So just two more. The Lifetime Achievement Award at the 8th Annual Construction Week Awards 2018 and the Economic Times Lifetime Achievement Award for Corporate Excellence 2018, which was conferred on him very recently. Xavier University Bhubaneswar is proud to honor this doyen of Indian industry and bestow on him the honorary doctorate degree in management, given at the Xavier Institute of Management on December 5th, 2018 at Bhubaneswar, signed Vice Chancellor, Xavier University, signed Registrar, Xavier University. Now I request our chairman, Sri Rajiv Kaul, to give away the certificate. And also the gold medal. I now request our Vice Chancellor, Father Paul Fernandez, to honor Mr. Godrej with a shawl. And also the seal of the university. And finally, a memento to be given to him by Professor Subhajyoti Ray, Dean of XIMB.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Father. Now, I would like to take the privilege of inviting Sri Adi Godrej, the chief guest and speaker for the evening, to address the gathering. So please.
Thank you. Mr. Rajiv Kaul, dignitaries on the dais, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for this wonderful honor. It gives me great pleasure to be here this evening at the Foundation Day celebration of the Xavier University and to have the privilege of receiving the honorary doctorate in the presence of luminaries on the dais and young, budding professionals present here in great numbers. The Godrej Group shares a long and fulfilling relationship with your distinguished institute, with several of your alumni joining our company every year in various divisions and functions. I am particularly pleased to be here today, as I attended St. Xavier's School for 7 years and St. Xavier's College for 2 years in Mumbai before leaving for the US for my higher studies. The name Xavier rings a very pleasant bell. Today I would like to speak about the future of consumer goods in India. In the recent years, this has been one of the most rapidly evolving landscapes in India, as an outcome of structural, competitive, and regulatory developments. The last few years have been mixed for the Indian economy. GDP grew by approximately 7.1% in financial year 17 and 6.7% in financial year 18. FMCG as a sector in India has pivoted over the last decade. Till about financial year 12, FMCG on an average used to grow ahead of GDP, while between financial year 13 and 16, FMCG growth has lagged economic growth. At approximately $50 billion, serving nearly 1.2 billion people through over 8 million outlets, the sector is large. Yet FMCG value growth witnessed a continuous declining trend till recently, from 17% growth rate in 2011 to 8% in 2017. Thankfully, the trend now seems to be reversing. The overall macroeconomic outlook is positive, and having turned a corner after the transitionary negative impacts of demonetization and GST faded, India's GDP growth for financial year 19 is now estimated to be about 7.8%, although the latest estimates have reduced it a little bit, but we are likely to grow well above last year's growth. Although, while we are still riddled with several challenges on inflation, exchange rates, input prices, etc., this makes India the fastest growing major economy in the world, ahead of China. FMCG too has seen a recovery in financial 18, with the sector growing at 13%. However, one needs to be cautious here. While the sector growth is strong, there have been several structural shifts in recent years, making the blueprint for success for incumbents look quite different now as compared to a decade earlier. Let me now talk about five key trends that I think will continue to shape the consumer goods space looking ahead. Rural continues to be growth driver. Over the last 2 years, rural has consistently outperformed urban, with rural growing at 12% versus urban at 10%. This outperformance sustained even the years of FMCG slowdown, for example, in 2016. With increasing accessibility and reach of media, the influence of urban India on rural India has been increasing. Rural consumers want to mimic their urban counterparts, and given their starting position, have significant headroom for growth. They are shifting from mass brands to popular and premium products. They are more willing to spend on discretionary items. With the increasing penetration of mobile internet, some large top-end rural pockets in the country now behave more like small towns. There is a progressive rural India that is emerging. In fact, this segment has contributed substantially to the revenues of the consumer products businesses of Godrej over the last few years. Companies at large are hence coming up with innovative solutions to tap into the potential of the rural market. At Godrej, for instance, we launched Chotu Cool, a small affordable refrigerator that consumes less than half the power that a regular refrigerator does. An ideal product for rural consumers who would like to keep their food fresh but may not be able to afford the price tag of a regular refrigerator or may not have regular electricity supply to keep a normal refrigerator running. Digital and e-commerce are democratizing the playing field. By 2020, nearly one-third of FMCG and nearly two-thirds of beauty and hygiene space is expected to be digitally influenced, which implies that online channels become critical to influence consumer purchase decisions. Further, as per Nielsen, e-commerce is expected to contribute about 10% plus of overall FMCG by 2030, which is an 8 times growth of its current size, which is less than 1% of FMCG today. This is a significant channel, rather omni-channel implications for companies. While they need to still focus on the traditional general and modern trade, where bulk of the market is today, explosive growth can come only by tapping effectively the more nascent digital and e-commerce channels. Rise of small packs across rural and urban. While overall consumption is rising across India, driven by rising incomes and education, small packs are growing much faster than larger packs. While this can be expected in rural, surprisingly, this is true even in urban India. For example, last year, small packs grew 1.6 times faster than overall market in rural, while 1.3 times faster in urban. This implies that consumers want more choice, want to experiment more. For companies, this implies that recruiting new consumers driven by strong innovation is a critical enabler for growth, rather than relying on increasing consumption or consumer loyalty. Naturals is the new buzzword. Patanjali's rise from less than 500 crore revenue in financial year 12 to approximately 10,000 crore in financial year 16 on the back of Ayurveda has kick-started a huge trend around naturals among consumers. While Patanjali itself has slowed down, degrowing in financial year 18, the naturals market has exploded with many incumbents innovating around this. Example, Colgate, Unilever, and Dabur. This trend is unlikely to reverse anytime soon as consumers become increasingly aware of ingredients, become health conscious, etc. Rise of smaller and regional FMCG brands. In the last year, while top approximately 50 FMCG companies accounting for approximately 60% of the market grew at around 11%, the 50,000 regional brands accounting for the remaining 40% grew at around 20%. What's more interesting is that this growth differential has been steadily increasing in the past few quarters. The September quarter saw smaller companies growing at around 38% versus national companies at around 15%. For large companies, this implies that they will need to think of a multi-local model, even within India, and approach each geography very differently, customized to local preferences, lest they may lose out to regional brands. I'd like to come to the Godrej story. I would like to spend some time talking about how the consumer goods business of Godrej has evolved. In 2011, we set ourselves the ambitious target to grow tenfold in the next 10 years. We continue to focus on our long-term ambition and are targeting our initiatives towards achieving it. We recently conducted an internal study that shows that around 750 million consumers in India and around 1.15 billion consumers across the globe use one or the other of our products each day, which gives us a very strong position in the consumer market. We would like to take this figure to much higher levels over the next 5 years. With such a large base, we could very well have the largest consumer footprint amongst companies headquartered in the developing world. The group is also very conscious of the needs and requirements of the end consumers. Breakthrough innovation is at the heart of our strategy. We're constantly focusing on providing value for money products to the Indian consumers through its personal care and home care portfolio. For example, we launched FastCard, India's first paper-based mosquito repellent, which is accessible and affordable by all, available at a price of ₹1. Likewise, our product Godrej Expert Creme offered pre-measured sachets of hair color at a disruptive price point of ₹30, which increased both accessibility and ease of use for the consumer. As recently as September this year, we launched Godrej Protect Magic Hand Wash, a disruptive powder to liquid hand wash at just ₹15. Which is unthinkable at the current price points in the hand wash market. Similarly, Air Pocket, an affordable yet sophisticated looking air fragrancing solution, has disrupted the air fragrance market, particularly in car fragrances. We're also increasingly focusing on our digital media and social media strategy. We're experimenting with innovative ways of reaching to the digital consumer of today. A consumer is no longer a passive recipient of products being placed on the shelf or being advertised in the media. Consumers today play an active role during different stages of a product life cycle, whether it is co-creating products along with the companies or providing real-time feedback on social media. The consumer today can influence the product reaching to him or her in multiple ways. Godrej Consumer Products, for instance, crowdsourced the idea behind the new fragrance for Air, our air freshener brand. We got a good response during the exercise. Over 1,000 respondents shared the inputs through tweets, Facebook messages, and blogs, with the help of which we launched 2 new variants of the product. With higher capacity to spend, increased awareness, and more choice available at hand, the consumers today are willing to experiment more. Hence, the need for innovation in consumer products is only going to increase. Consumers are willing to reward for innovation. This is the next important trend that I think is shaping the industry and will continue to do so. But innovation is easier said than done. Nielsen reported in their Breakthrough Innovation Report for India that there are close to 15,000 new FMCG products launched annually in India, and only about 0.2% of these new launches achieve breakthrough success. Hence, consistent innovation requires a lot of things to be put into place: structured processes, systems and tools, but most important, commitment from senior leadership, and in some cases, even a major cultural shift. In consumer durables, innovation will likely focus on energy efficient and environment friendly products. In FMCG, a lot of the innovation in India will continue to be towards creating value for money products and increasing penetration of under-penetrated categories. A large section of FMCG market is still dominated by unbranded goods. These innovations will help consumers upgrade from unbranded to branded goods, especially in the food sector. At Godrej Consumer Products, new product development, including renovation, now contributes to nearly 35 to 40% of our total revenues. Over the last few years, we have accelerated our efforts on innovation by dedicating resources and putting structured processes and systems behind it. We're also fostering a design-driven thinking in our consumer goods, appliances, furniture, and real estate businesses. Design thinking is now being seen as a strategic tool by many FMCG companies, which are trying to change the ways of working to effectively deploy this tool. Government's favorable initiatives and improvement of India's image as an investment destination. While there are several socio-economic and consumer trends that are shaping the consumer goods space in India, and companies are latching onto them, this discussion would be incomplete without talking about the role played by the government in driving growth in this sector. Over the last few years, the government has introduced several measures to incentivize businesses in India. The full force implementation of GST, Goods and Services Tax, was a huge leap forward in this direction. Hearteningly, India jumped 23 places to rank 77 from rank 100 in the recently conducted Ease of Doing Business survey by the World Bank. We saw a similar jump even in previous years, moving from rank 142 in 2014 to rank 77 in 2018. There is undoubtedly a long way ahead for the sector. I have a lot of expectations from the upcoming union budget for the consumer goods industry. It should be a growth-oriented budget. It is good to see that the government is planning a full budget in 2019 and not a vote on account ahead of the elections. The government needs to have undeterred focus moving ahead on continuing to strengthen the fundamentals of the economy and also key growth accretive sectors like FMCG. Equally important would be the role of the incumbent companies to leverage the macro environment well by pushing for disruptive innovation and consumer-first thinking. This is an interesting time for the consumer goods industry and the right time for companies to seize the opportunity at hand. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you very much, Mr. Adi Godrej. In our tradition, now the floor is open. I think we have about maybe 20 minutes to half an hour for questions to Mr. Adi Godrej. So can we begin with the students first? Hopefully entirely students. Who's going to raise the hand first? Are you holding a camera or the mic? I'm not quite sure. The lights are there. If you could just give your name and which class you're in, and then Mr. Godrej would be happy to reply.
Yeah, hello, good evening, sir. I'm Soumya Tiwari from BM second year. First of all, sir, it's a pleasure having you on campus. Welcome.
Thank you.
So my question is regarding GCPL's business in the Latin American markets. So as we all know, Venezuela is a part of the is part of Latin America, and it's one of the worst performing economies in the world. It basically is an economy that relied a lot on its oil reserves, and in the last decade or so, it's really been at the precipice of a complete catastrophic breakdown. So in such a situation, sir, I mean, in the recent times, in the last 4-5 years. The prices of consumer goods in countries like Venezuela has actually risen and it's gone beyond the capacity of a normal individual. So how exactly do responsible consumer goods companies like GCPL look at providing the benefits to consumers in such economies? Thank you so much, sir.
Fortunately, we don't operate in Venezuela.
Right, sir.
We operate across Latin America quite considerably.
Yes, sir.
Manufacturing operations are in Argentina, Chile, and Uruguay. And we sell from there in other Latin American countries. But fortunately, because of Venezuela's situation, we've never entered that market, and we are not affected by the present ridiculous situation in Venezuela.
Thank you so much, sir.
Good evening, sir. My name is Supratik.
Where are you? Sorry, yeah.
Good evening, sir. My name is Supratik, first year BM.
Yeah.
So you spoke about being innovative and being a disruptive force in the market. The thing that we have generally observed is that as companies grow bigger, it becomes difficult for them, you know, to be innovative because they tend to get set in their ways. So how does Godrej really go about being innovative and disruptive? Thank you.
So we have a lot of internal mechanisms to encourage continuous innovation. We also have a system of what we call continuous improvement. Even if a business is doing exceedingly well, we expect it to keep on looking for improvement, not sit in a satisfied manner. That works extremely well. We use a lot of techniques to encourage that. Most of all, we encourage working as a group. We encourage teamwork. And we encourage people to think of the word we rather than the word I. And that works quite well in many different directions.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
My name Avan Mahanti. I am from Executive MBA batch. I just have a simple question to you, sir. Because you know, Godrej is the leading player in mosquito repellent market, And in my state, also in many states, in districts like Koraput, Balangir, the brain malaria and malaria is a big menace there. And I know Godrej is doing very good innovation in developing products. But still, I think for those rural areas where people are really don't have access to good quality mosquito repellent, if Godrej can develop something which is really cheap and they can afford it and which may be effective for this mosquito repelling these kind of mosquitoes, so it will be a great help to those people, because I have been to those places and it's a big challenge there, because people are can't afford to this good night oil and this kind of things. So that's just a simple question, sir, if you can just put something light on that.
You are right. Affordability is extremely important in mosquito repellents. So we have a product, a paper called Fast Card, which costs 1 rupee. And it, when you burn it, it burns for about a minute and repels a lot of mosquitoes. We have a lot of new solutions coming up with a low cost, including applying a mosquito repellent on your clothes, particularly for children. It's very nice when they go outdoors. So we have a lot of very low cost solutions. At the same time, we have good solutions for in-home use. Earlier, mosquito repellents were mainly used, I would say, by earlier I mean 20 years ago, mainly used against mosquito nuisance. Then of course, malaria spread a lot. Knowledge about malaria spread a lot. And a lot of mosquito repellents started being used to prevent malaria. Then dengue came about. Earlier people had not heard of dengue. And dengue is a different daytime mosquito than caused by malaria, which is a nighttime mosquito. So we have had solutions for dengue also. So mosquito nuisance is a very big global problem, and we are leaders by far in India. We have about 50% of the mosquito repellent market in India. We are also in repellents for other insects like cockroaches, etc. And we have leadership positions in other countries also in mosquito and other insect repellent products.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
I'm Swaha Paringrai from BM First Year. My question is, what are the various retail norms that can be adopted in our pursuit of entering the inelusive top 50 rank of ease of doing business? Because with the recent stock volatility, as well as the saturation that the market has reached, what can be done more to provide a stimulus in our pursuit to enter the top 50 rank?
Yeah. First of all, the good news is we are far from reaching saturation. FMCG markets in the developed world have reached more or less saturation levels. So growth is slow. But in India, there are only 3 categories of packaged branded goods which every family uses. One is toilet soaps, second is some form of detergent, and the third is matchsticks. No other form of packaged goods is fully consumed by all families in India. So the opportunity for growth in India for the FMCG category, to my mind, is huge over the next 20 years, because increased penetration will come about. As incomes rise, all families will want to use a wide range of products, particularly packaged, branded food products. So I think the scope for consumer products growth in India is tremendous. That's one of the reasons why India has become the fastest growing major economy in the world. And I think unless we make major mistakes, we will continue to remain the fastest growing major economy in the world.
Thank you.
Hello, sir. So this is Rizul Agarwal from BM First Year. So my question is that you said that India is the fastest growing consumer product market as well as the fastest growing economies in the world. Innovation in the companies are evident, which requires a lot of manufacturing processes to be exhibited. Now, the question is how sustainability at Godrej along with the manufacturing goes hand in hand, and what are the sustainability initiatives for the better future of the generations, for a natural, to give them a better natural resource appetite? What is the roadmap of Godrej on those lines?
So we do a lot of R&D. We do a lot of consumer understanding, visiting consumer homes and understanding their needs and consulting with consumers is a major part of the effort of a large number of our team. And that helps a lot. And in India, we will need to do much more of that in understanding consumer needs and then translating it through R&D into developing products, then adequately testing them out. So a general consumer focus, increased consumer focus, is the need of the time.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Yes,
sir. Sorry, yeah.
My name is Suman Saurabh Mohanty. I'm from first year BM. So my question is, the FMCG industry has a long history of generating reliable growth through mass brands, but now it faces great pressure as consumer behaviors shift and the channel landscape changes. In these situations, FMCGs need to reduce the reliance on mass brands and offline mass channels. How is Godrej coming up with a winning model for creating value with respect to such a brand relevance?
Yeah, so I would say that FMCG needs to do a lot of out-of-the-box thinking as things are changing, as you rightly described it. But it doesn't have to stray from strong brand promotion and brand growth. Brands are very important because consumers can rely upon them. But improving the total inputs into brands is going to be much more important than in the past. So I don't think we should think the brands are going to be less important, but how you treat brands, how you promote brands, and how do you go about brand building will need to change dramatically.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
I'm Saurav Sambit Mishra from Business Management Program, second year. Sir, in the lecture you pointed out, e-commerce should be accounting nearly 10% of the consumer product sector in the coming years. And with the recent Walmart Flipkart acquisition, India has come to the center stage of the global e-commerce market. Sir, how is Godrej's strategic team approaching this? So are we seeing a specialized consumer products e-commerce platform from Godrej in the recent years? Will this be a reality in the coming years? I would like your comments on this. Thank you.
So I think we should realize that e-commerce is getting very important all over the world. It is gaining an importance in India too. But there are certain categories in which e-commerce is growing much more rapidly. Take, for example, books. It's almost totally dominated by e-commerce, but not in all categories. Even in FMCG, globally, e-commerce does not play as much of a role. So today, as I mentioned in my talk, e-commerce plays about a 1% role in total FMCG offtake, and I expect it'll go up very considerably, but it's not going to be the dominant. Today, the dominant retail outlet for FMCG is Kirana stores. India has more stores than any other country in the world. We have about roughly 10 million retail outlets in India. The next highest would be China with about 4.5 million outlets, and Indonesia and US with about 2 million outlets each. So that's still very important. And modernizing the Kirana store method of sale is also very important. So there'll be a lot of different directions we'll need to take in, and not just one direction, not just one change, but several, and they'll have to be coordinated very well. And I think one of the things that doesn't allow coordination well is when we leave different things in an organization to different people. Teamwork will be very important. Coordinating among themselves by the team will be very important.
Thank you, sir.
Should we finish it?
Hello, sir. I'm Udita from BM First Year. So I have read in the news that Godrej has become carbon neutral. So all the products that Godrej is manufacturing, they are green and natural. So I want to know that, considering the fact that most of the manufacturing industry, they take care of the operating cost and setup cost of the renewable sources. So what has been your motivation making Godrej carbon neutral?
So we are strong believers in the eco-preservation in the future. We think it's an extremely important part of business, and we have been practicing it a lot. We preserve a very large mangrove forest, which is in Mumbai city, and it is 4 times the size of Central Park in New York. And we do a lot of other activities which are towards that. In Godrej Properties, all our buildings are environment rated. So we take a lot of steps to go forward. Now let me tell you an important factor. While originally this was started as an environment friendly move, we found that it saves money. And what is very important is if all companies in India become environment friendly, carbon neutrality seeking, solar and wind energy promoting, it can not only help India's environmental future, India's climate future, but it can save money. That is not being easily realized yet by business. So Godrej, sponsored with CII, CII Environment Friendly Business Center in Hyderabad many years ago, where we built the first, the highest rated building outside the United States, environmentally rated building. And that has done a lot of work to try and teach CII members that this direction can not only be very good for the country's future, but it can be very good for the company's future.
Thank you, sir.
It's time for non-students also.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
I am Aditya Jha from BM First Year. So my question is, Godrej Group has been since the onset of 20th century, and it has withstand every political and technological changes we have ever seen in modern times. But what lies ahead is the super human disruptive power in the form of AI, machine learning, deep learning, industrial revolution 4.0, and all these things which required a lot of computation and analytics. So how does a FMCG company like Godrej prepare itself for this disruptive force?
Sorry, I couldn't hear your question properly.
Yes, sir. Repeating again, Godrej Group has been since the onset of 20th century, and it has withstand every political and technological disruptive force ever seen in modern times. But what lies ahead is super human disruption based, which requires a lot of computation and analytics like artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning, industrial revolution 4.0, and all these things. So how does a FMCG company in these times prepare itself for this this disruption?
Yes, so there will be tremendous changes. There are changes going on, and we will have to adapt to that. It's a must. If you don't adapt, you won't be able to compete and you'll fall off the roster. So adaption to these changes, incorporating these changes, will be extremely important.
Thank you, sir.
So we have a lot of teams working on this, and a lot of teams, I can't tell you exactly what they're doing because I'm myself not aware of some of the developments that take place. But our teams work in this direction, and they are successfully doing so, I feel.
Hello, sir. I am Anuva Patnaik, a member of Legislative Assembly and a board, a member of the Governing Board. I'd like to ask you one question. That, as you know, Odisha is one of the fastest growing state in the country, and Bhubaneswar has recently been accorded as one of the fast smart city. And just last month, we have concluded our Make in Odisha conclave, where a lot of industries have placed a lot of investment in Odisha. May I ask you that, being one of the premier's consumer durable company, do you plan to have some investment in Odisha, since Odisha is one of the most fastest growing state and is like to cater the eastern part of the country, and which would be beneficial for both you as a company and for the state also? Thank you.
We already have investments in Odisha, and our company Godrej Agrovet is quite involved, especially in the oil palm plantation, and we plan to increase that investment and grow in Odisha.
Okay, thank you.
Good evening. I am Pritish Gupta. I am an alumnus from the first batch of the institute, and it's a real pleasure to have you here. My question is that Godrej is undoubtedly known as an extremely ethical group operating amongst the corporate groups in the country. So I really wish to know how you have been successful in bringing about this cultural challenge in terms of ensuring that this percolates down through generations. It's not easy, I know.
Yeah, well, two or three different things. One is our values are sent down the various layers of our management very strongly, and determination to stick to the values, because in the long run, that pays. Secondly, we have intentionally stayed out of certain sectors where we felt interaction with government bodies would be at a high level, so that we don't sacrifice our values. That's one of the reasons we are largely in consumer businesses. So a combination of these philosophies has propelled us. And I think it also went well with the fact that our brand became more and more popular, as I described in my talk. And so therefore, sticking to consumer product made more and more sense in the way we expanded our business.
Thank you.
Maybe we can take just one or two last questions, and we can throw it open to everyone now, in case any faculty or guest or board member wishes to ask a question. If not, do I see any hands? Yeah, okay, we have hands there. Last two questions.
A very good evening, sir. It's a pleasure having you here, firstly.
Thank you.
And thank you for mentioning about Godrej Agrovet. And there's just a very basic thing that we would like to know more about Godrej Agrovet as a whole. So platforms such as Omnivore, where the investments are made with the startups that are really bringing up technologies with respect to increasing productivity in lines of agriculture and everything, specifically with regard to state of Odisha. What other such concepts that can be brought up in the line of AgroVet itself?
So Godrej AgroVet is a business we started many decades ago. We used to manufacture vegetable oils through solvent extraction to use in our oleochemicals and soap businesses. And the byproduct, which was oil cake, was exported globally for animal feed manufacture. Then we decided several decades ago to get into animal feed manufacture ourselves. We became the largest animal feed manufacturer in India, and we also bought over Hindustan Lever's animal feed business, which added considerably to our size and growth. And then from animal feeds, we expanded into other agri areas like agri-chemicals, oil palm plantation, because India is a very big palm oil importer, and many other areas. And Godrej AgroVet grew. It was part of the then Godrej Soaps. Then we separated it into a separate company called Godrej AgroVet. And last October, we listed it for the first time. And it did very well in its listing. It was oversubscribed about 100 times, sorry. And so it's a company with a great future. And we think India's march in the agri and animal husbandry field will be quite rapid. And we think Godrej AgroVet will play its part in this.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
So good evening, sir. My name is Basu Suman. I'm a student of business management. So my question is, so we have always like been saying that India is the largest, fastest growing major economy right now. And there's always a talk about the demographic dividend. That is, so but my question is, the parameters are not that optimistic. So do you think, like having also been involved with CII, do you think the industry has been able to respond to that? And are we really looking at demographic dividends in the next 15, 20 years? Or will this be turn out to be a demographic disaster?
No, I don't think it'll be a demographic disaster. How much of a demographic dividend we can reap from it depends on how well we go about it. Two things are very important. Much greater attention to education and skilling and training needs to be provided in the Indian economy. So sometimes I like to say there is no unemployment in India. It's unemployability. People don't have the skills that are required for the modern economy. And we need to provide skilling and training in two ways, by having proper institutional skilling and training programs, and companies need to do a lot of skilling and training. Fortunately, with the mandatory corporate social responsibility requirements, a lot of that budget goes towards skilling and training. And I think we are moving in the right direction. Any country which has had the past kind of history we had, two kinds of histories. One is British colonialism, which was economically disastrous. And secondly, 40 years of excessive socialism, which was also, to my mind, economically disastrous. In 91, we changed our thinking, and we have improved. If economic growth goes well, it is quite possible that by 2050, by purchasing power parity, India might become the largest economy in the world, overtaking both. Today, we are the third largest by purchasing power parity, after China is number one, US is two, and India is three. We could well become the largest. And as you mentioned, I think some of our advantages in demographic dividend could be reaped, provided we approach it the right way.
Thank you, sir.
Vice Chancellor Father Paul says we have time for one or two more questions.
Are there any? Yeah, I see 3-4 hands. Yeah. You don't mind, do you? Are you okay?
Yeah, yeah, I'm okay.
Hello, sir. Yes, sir. Welcome to our campus. My question is regarding the corporate social responsibility. First of all, my name is Saurav. I am from BM second year. So we know each and every company has a certain amount to spend every annual year towards corporate social responsibility. So my question is, as a company, Godrej as a company, do you have specific teams to design where to spend the corporate social responsibility, whatever you are supposed to spend, or you feel that there should be some third party whom you count upon to spend your corporate social responsibility so that it reaches the actual needy?
So let me explain. Several of our companies have corporate social responsibility budgets, and we have a common body in the Godrej Group called Godrej Good and Green, which supervises our corporate social responsibility implementation. We do use other bodies in certain cases, but we do a lot of projects ourselves. And we have found it extremely useful to do corporate social responsibility initiatives, which help not only society and people, but also help our company. For example, we have a corporate social responsibility program which trains housewives to run hair salons from their homes, which has been extremely successful. Thousands of people have successfully done it. And it is helping our business also, because they tend to consume our products. So I'm a great believer in encouraging things that have a dual objective, more than one objective. And we have been quite successful in our corporate social responsibility. At the same time, we support a lot of outside entities that practice corporate social responsibility.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
I'm from the marketing area. I'm a faculty over here. I always wanted to ask you that Godrej has always been synonymous with what you started off with, which was basically safes, and it was synonymous with security. And now that you have branched out into so many other areas, consumer products, agro products, and various other things which you have mentioned, has there been any strategic attempt to tie all this together and come out with some, you know, unification of the entire group, or you plan to stand out as standalone companies?
So as I mentioned, we have several initiatives, such as we have a group called Godrej Good and Green, which coordinates our corporate social responsibility programs. We have a group that looks at our brand and group promotion and thinking. And we are also trying to, a lot of people feel that we are a locks and soap company. So we try and promote the fact, not too many people know about it, but we've done campaigns to promote it, that we are suppliers to the Indian space program, the Indian nuclear program. So we try and promote that part of it. At the same time, we have benefited a lot from independently promoting our various businesses to be separate. And we've benefited a lot by demerging businesses from larger companies, because then there is an ability to concentrate strongly on promoting that business. So you need both a coordination of the business, as you rightly put it, as well as independence of operation to
push growth.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Can we make that the last question from the young lady?
Thank you. Sir, this is Aditi Sharma.
Hi.
BM first year. Sir, Godrej has been a pioneer in green buildings. Most of its buildings are either platinum rating, gold rating. Along with that, it has Godrej Agrovet, which is, again, a lot into sustainability. You also provide sustainable consultancies. Godrej Nature Basket is one such initiative where a lot in the organic, organic consumer goods was one such initiative, but there is a lot of limited growth in this space. I believe that a consumer, when they can be educated, a lot again can be changed when it comes to sustainability. What is the initiative and what is the vision of Godrej to turn Godrej Nature Basket into a huge consumer success?
Well, I wish my daughter was answering the question. She's the chairman of the
yes.
company.
Yes, sir.
I don't follow all our businesses in great detail, but Godrej Nature's Basket has a great future. There's a lot of restructuring being done as to how to position it to grow. And it's one of the few private businesses other than Godrej and Boyce in our group. But we see a lot of opportunities.
Thank you, sir.
Godrej is a Xavierite, very much a Xavierian. He studied for 5 years or 7 years in the school.
Seven in school and two in university.
In college, right?
In college, yeah.
I'm told from sources that he was a good student. I'm told that he never misbehaved and was never punished. He never was made to stand for 1 hour in the corner of the classroom. But in Bhubaneswar, Mr. Ali Godrej is standing for more than 1 hour. So he truly deserves a continuous applause. Please join me in giving that to him.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your inspirational views and the insightful talk about how the consumer market witnessed a downtrend and then recovered post-demonetization and GST. You also touched upon the changing landscape in rural India, the importance of digital and e-commerce channel, the rise of small packs and regional FMCG organizations, the need for innovation in consumer products, and how consumer focus is becoming more and more important. Now, I would like to request Dr. Father Paul Fernandez to deliver the vote of thanks.
Good evening and thank you for the, I think Sir Adi Godrej deserves a greater round of applause. Let's all stand and give him a, okay? And it's a delightful evening for all of us, you know? When a doctorate is conferred upon a person, the dean or the head of the institution gets the first privilege to call him Dr. Sir Adi Godrej. Thank you, sir. So, we'd like to also thank you for your life lived in the simplicity and in an inspirational way, and building up the family business and making it a global business today. And this is a model, and I think our young students can write several case studies on this, and it'll be good for everyone to be enlightened by their business model. Are there anybody who wants to take up this challenge of writing case studies? Come on, you guys. How many hands are up? Raise your hands. There are some hands, and it'll be a good model, and you can write and make it available for everyone for the future, for inspiration. Today is the Foundation Day, and this is a day for us to thank God for all the graces and gifts that you have received, of course, over the years, but particularly during the last year. And we look forward to the next year. So in a big way, there are many blessings, and we thank God, and while we thank God, we make these blessings ours, and particularly we are grateful for all the students. They are our first blessings given to us by God to nurture the leadership in them, in you, and for the future. As I say this, I would like to rapidly mention a few things. First of all, we have our chairman and the board of governors. So a big round of applause and thanks to them for guiding the institution over the 31 years exam here and the university over the 5 years. I have my faculty colleagues. A big round of applause, those who are present here and also the others. For, you know, we have a very participatory system, and everybody thinks I do all the work, but it's actually done by everyone. We have about 40 committees here and about 40 committees in the other campus. So we have a very distributed system. And very often the deans and associate deans lead these teams. So let's give the deans and associate deans, because they do all the academic work, keeping the quality high, and so on. I'd like to thank my Jesuit colleagues. You know, behind there is always somebody always supporting us. They're all here, many of them, several of them. Thank you for your support and God's blessings always. They pray for us all the time, and I think it's a good thing. And so thank you for all the support. The Jesuits have been sacrificing a lot over the years, you know, building this up for the future. You don't see it very often, but they are there always, constant source of support. I'd like to also mention a few things. This year we added the law school, among other schools. One of the things which you know. But it's a big initiative. Hopefully it will grow and grow into a great school. So also we are going to add a few things to be future ready. One of the things we're going to add in this coming year is M.Tech in artificial intelligence. You know, this is the big buzzword. We want to be ready, and we're starting the M.Tech from July 2019. It's on the website, yeah. So that's something good. We're going to add Masters in Data Science. You can clap maybe at the end, okay? Masters in Data Science, that's another big initiative. And the third one, an Executive MBA in Business Analytics, okay? These are the three programs that will get us future ready. We're going to add a program in public policy somewhere down the line, 2019 in July. Also a BSc in environmental science and one executive program in agribusiness. And so about 6-7 programs are on, so the faculty groups are busy in various ways, preparing various things. Of course, they keep me also busy, but it's a kind of a, in the preparation that's going on, you don't see it, but it's happening. And you will see it when June or July comes, 2019. So to all, Besides the faculty staff, we have a whole about 250 staff, both this campus and the other campus put together. They do a whole lot of work, that's why I said, okay. Though they are not present here, let's record our appreciation for them. They do a lot of work, including all the preparations that they have done for this day, for our celebration. So as we celebrate the thanks, once again, sir, I want to thank you for coming to us and being with us and being the inspiration for us. Thank you very much. We love you. And I think everyone thanks you for answering all their questions. So both for him, for answering the questions, and for those who, you know, actively asked all those questions, let's give them a big thank you. Thank you. Yeah. So shall we stand up for the national anthem?
I request everyone to please sing along with us the national anthem.
Jan gana mana adhinayak jaya hai Bharat bhagya vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravid Utkal Vanga Vindh Himachal Yamuna Ganga Uchal Jaladhi Taranga Tav Shubh Name Jage Tav Shubh Aashish Maage Gahe Tav Jayo Gatha जनगण मंगल धायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
Of the Foundation Day Lecture 2018. I request the audience to please remain seated till the dignitaries leave the auditorium. The second years are allowed to leave the auditorium. The first years, please remain seated.